Of concerned with, there are legal mechanisms to accumulate property rights virtually without limit under unified management for a purely private purpose, while limiting the liability of the owners for consequences of their actions. Basically, an invitation to irresponsibility. Now, at least technically, for most of the period, management was not immune from prosecution, but somehow the law seems to have morphed so that it's not only the shareholders, but also the managers that are no longer responsible for the consequences of their action. And we, of course, saw that in the most recent financial crash, where we never saw any top bankers go to jail. There were a few slap-on-the-wrist fines, which essentially were burdens on the shareholders, but no take-backs from the ill-gotten gains of managers. Now, I had a few years ago, I was in Amsterdam. A friend took me to museum, the stock market museum there, which is where, that was the original stock market in Amsterdam, actually out in a field. So I was very interested in this museum. It was essentially a museum of financial fraud and scandal, bubbles and manipulation. And one of the things we become aware of is that, you know, financial bubbles boom and collapse. Is not a recent phenomenon. It's been going on ever since we had publicly traded corporations and traded securities. It's really creating an ideal vehicle for playing financial games, for creating bubbles. And of course, as we noted in the 2008 collapse, if you're really clever, you can create a bubble. The bubble collapses. People get caught with mortgages they can't pay. They end up losing their houses. The bankers that created the collapse get the assets cheap, and we go through another round. Now, what we see out of this is that markets need rules, and much of our legal manipulation has been about removing the rules that govern the market. This is a basic thing about market economics. You know, you hear the language free market? You know, we used to just have markets. Now, even us progressives, if you mention market, you say free market. You know, that's a politically loaded term. It means an unregulated market. If you really understand markets, there are no markets without rules, because they quickly become non-markets. Have you ever played the game Monopoly?
Yeah.
You ever notice what happens? Somebody ends up with everything. That's exactly the way an unregulated market works. The winners get more power, more market power. They're able to get more of the assets until the game's no longer any fun. Now, after the great crash of 1929 and got into the Great Depression, and we had the Roosevelt administration with time, brought a lot of these institutions under control. And between the financial reforms and the World War II, we came out with a strong middle class. It involved a lot of rules and legislation, progressive taxation, social safety net, rules that allow for strong labor unions, limits on corporate size. You know, to have a competitive market, you've got to keep the individual units small. It's interesting, again, the way we get the things turned around. You know, we hear the argument, well, we have to let these firms merge so they can become more competitive. So they can compete with the other monopolies. Yeah, and then, anyhow, we had for a time, we had rules that kept the biggest corporations broken up so that at least there was some semblance of competition and market discipline. We actually had a time when we really punished corporations that were breaking the law and engaging in unethical behavior. And sometimes their charters were withdrawn, which is a death sentence for a corporation. We had rules in the banking system that separated commercial banks, banks that do basic functions like cashing checks and taking your deposits and making loans to local businesses and homeowners, and a wall between them and the investment banks that invested for their own account. And we also had a unitary local banking system. Many of you look like you're more or less of my age. You may recall when we were growing up that most of our banks were local banks. Many states, we had a unitary banking rule, which meant if you had a bank, you couldn't have any physical facility more than 500 feet from your front door. That's a very different system. Of course, many of our financial institutions were cooperatives, but they were mostly all locally owned. They were in the business of providing financial services to the members of their community. Okay, so we've gone through this period of deregulation and dismembered much of that. But remembering back when we had these rules, when we had constraints, rules on the market, and built the middle class. I remember growing up being so proud of the United States as we were a middle class nation. Now, we did have some extremes of wealth and poverty, and many of us in the white community were not really all that aware of the realities of communities of color, particularly African Americans. But we did have a reputation largely deserved in the world as a predominantly middle class nation. Now, as Tom points out, this became an irritant to the economic royals. Now, you may go remember going way back to the founding of the nation, there was a question of whether we should be a monarch. And Alexander Hamilton was one who argued that we should, in fact, have a king. He ended up being head of finance and organizing the financial system. Anyhow, part of what Tom reminds us is that we have had a class from the beginning in the United States that was really anti-democracy. And out of this period of the middle class, when we thought we had a social contract between labor, government, and corporations, there was a group that was very irritated. They felt their power and their privilege was being undermined. They were very concerned of the unruly masses, if we had real democracy, and the flower children, many of us in this room, were getting out of hand, not properly disciplined, going to be a threat to the order and to the economy. And back in 1972, there was a lawyer named Lewis Powell who wrote a memo to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, expressing concern about the war against capitalism, the war against proper elite rule that was threatened by the flower child movement, as well as competition from Asian countries. And he laid out to the corporate CEOs, to the Chamber of Commerce, a strategy for taking back power. And as Tom describes it, an outright and intentional attack on democracy, on the middle class, and perhaps less mentioned, on the market itself. You know, the market, as Adam Smith had in mind, a market of small businesses, of people meeting to exchange in a local marketplace. Now, he outlined a strategy by which corporate interests, by which the economic royalists could take control of the law, the legal system, the Supreme Court, by educating judges, indoctrinating judges, stacking the Supreme Court, infiltrating law schools to get the ideas of capitalism and the rights of corporations into legal education. They sponsored programs in universities around economics courses and the restructuring of economics as a discipline to focus on the interests of the corporation. They, as a strategy for taking control of the media, controlling the media message, and as partly shaping the message, but is also literally buying up the mainstream media, including television, to be sure to shape the message to suit the values of the economic royalists, and setting up policy think tanks to frame the debate. Now, at first, this program was focused nationally, national control. And as they began to consolidate, suppress the unions, begin to get control of the media and the legal system and reshaping academia, they began to reach out through the World Bank and IMF, structural adjustment to low-income countries in Africa, Asia, and Latin America, the kinds of things that Fran and I experienced in our international development work that ultimately led us to come back to where I wrote When Corporations Rule the World and to found Yes Magazine. Then they realized that they could use trade agreements, the GATT, form a World Trade Organization, NAFTA, what we're now seeing as the Trans-Pacific Partnership, other agreements being developed around Europe, and services agreement. But these agreements could be used to consolidate corporate rule everywhere and to shift the power, the decision-making, the rights above national levels so that you have a transnational system of corporate rule consolidated under global, unregulated global financial markets that allow for the playing of these games to create money out of nothing by manipulating the system, which then with that money you can buy up real resources around the world, take control of the land, the water, all the other essential means of living, and make them available to people only in return for their cheap labor or through borrowing. So essentially reducing all of us to conditions of debt slavery or wage slavery. And that process is playing out, and millions, not billions of people are feeling the consequences of it. Now, you've all noticed, I'm not telling you anything you don't know. And that's important. We know it, we see it, and we need to express it, and we need to act on it. Now, here's a particular conceptual piece. This comes down to organizational theory. If any of you are familiar with Jane Jacobs, putting it in a very simple frame, several years ago when Fran and I were living in Manila, we're having lunch with one of our Filipino economist friends, who was a very thoughtful, wise economist, Sixto Rojas. And I said, Sixto, can you explain to me why is it that economists so often come up with the wrong answer? He says, oh, that's easy. When they framed the models of the discipline, they had to make a choice. Which will be the foundational unit around which we build the discipline? Will it be the household or the firm? If any of you know the original origins of economics back in the day of Aristotle, economics meant the management of the household. The household is a human unit, a unit in which we make our living in a particular place with a house on the land. And of course, in the early days, that usually was the land from which we grew our food and subsisted in connection with our neighbors in the community through which we engaged in exchange. assistance. Now, if you organize around the household, you organize around making a living in the full sense of that word. If you organize around a firm detached from the household, your focus is simply on making as much money as possible. And he noted, this makes a big difference. If you're a firm, you want to get your work done, hiring the fewest possible people at the lowest possible wage. If you're a household, you want to get your members employed, get them all employed at the highest wage possible, if that's, you know, if employment is the goal. If you live next to a forest, you want to maintain that forest for all the benefits it provides, including cleaning the air, mediating the climate, providing all sources of wild products. If you're a logging company, a firm, hey, you come in and strip that out and sell it, and you move on to the next forest. Very different frame. Now, what we're dealing with is a question of, do we organize society around sovereign peoples who organize as nations, or do we organize around pools of money headed by corporate CEOs and banksters? Those are two fundamentally different ways of organizing. Democracy absolutely depends on our organization as nations. The sovereign people organizing as their sovereign nation to control their resources, set their priorities, set their rules for their economy, which is a fundamentally different frame and concept than organizing our global economy under global corporations that recognize no loyalty to any people or place, and that value only money and short-term profits, and value life only for its market price. And it becomes very clear that if we're organizing around corporations and financial markets as a global society, it absolutely guarantees moving ever faster toward extreme inequality and the destruction of Earth's capacity to support life and the destruction of any semblance of democracy. So you see what we're up against. We have many fronts on which we must absolutely act. And one that is truly fundamental is taking back our Constitution, rolling back the Supreme Court, and eliminating corporate rights. And with that, I turn it over to our panel, and we're going to hear about what we're doing in the UUs and beyond to address this absolutely fundamental issue.
It's my pleasure now to introduce Kim Europe-Lunz, who is the head of UU Justice Florida and is personally responsible for getting, I would say, half or more of Florida involved with the Move to Amend organization and now with the Interfaith Caucus, and she will start telling us about that.
And thanks to everyone for being here. My name is Kim Europe-Lunz, and if you see these being passed around, this is the main message of my short time up here. This is a copy of a shortened copy of the Move to Amend resolution that we're hoping every congregation, every UU congregation will pass as a congregation, okay? And this is a very simple, basic resolution that says, whereas Unitarian Universalists affirm and promote the seven principles and live our faith by living our principles, whereas the fifth principle is the right of conscience and the use of the democratic process within our congregations and in society at large, be it resolved that the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of your city, your state, stands with the Move to Amend campaign and communities across the country to defend democracy from the corrupting effects effects of undue corporate power by amending the United States Constitution to establish that one, only human beings, not corporations, are endowed with constitutional rights, and two, money is not speech, and therefore regulating political contributions and spending is not equivalent to limiting political speech. And be it further resolved that the Unitarian Universalist Congregation of your city, your state, hereby joins with other organizations statewide to instruct our state and federal representatives to enact resolutions and legislation to advance this effort. You want to put the date the resolution was approved, who made the motion, who made the second, the number of ayes, the number of nays, the number of abstentions, and have the secretary of your congregation sign it, your board secretary, and print the name, and then submit it to the national website. We want every congregation, Union congregation in the country, if possible, to be on board, and then reach out to our interfaith partners, okay? Okay? Let's do it. Now, just a brief history. In 2003, the UU World had a cover story with three articles about corporate personhood. 2003. In 2011, there was an AIW, Action of Immediate Witness, that this body passed that said, overturn Citizens United, support free speech for people. And this was after UUs began supporting Move to Amend in 2010, after that unfortunate, horrible Supreme Court decision, Citizens United versus the Federal Election Commission, January 21st, 2010, that has totally changed our country and our democracy forever. We've got to change that. We've got to change that, and we can. The UUA board of the Unitarian Universalist Association, the board of the UU Service Committee has already endorsed it way back when. Okay, by 2012, 21 UU congregations had already endorsed Move to Amend. And then the UUs for Just Economic Community, of which Michael is a member, Judith Peterson Ben is a member, and Marsha Myers is a member, and others in this country here, they proposed the Action of Immediate Witness in 2013 that was debated back and forth, and some people said, oh, don't use Move to Amend. I mean, Public Citizen has a resolution, and with their various ones, and by the time the mini assemblies got through with it, it said exactly what the Move to Amend resolution says, okay, and that's on your program. And it says, amend the Constitution. Corporations are not persons, and money is not speech. Yes, let's do it. Stuff. Okay, great. Perfect. Yes? climate change totally dominated by the money that is going into disinformation about climate change. I live in Florida. My governor says, don't, if you work for the state government, don't use the term climate change. So does Scott Walker in Wisconsin. He's telling the state people, don't use the term climate change. What is this? We have to change this. We have to counteract that money. And I use it as a model. I'm actually saying, it's a David and Goliath situation, to be sure. Okay, have any of you seen that? It's a picture, it's sort of a cartoon of an octopus. And the eyes of the octopus are the two pictures of the Koch brothers, David and Charles. The eyes of the octopus, and the tentacles go everywhere. As David Korten just said, that was back in 1971, the Powell Memorandum, 71 was it, 72? 72, the Powell Memorandum? The same thing's happening now. The Koch brothers are buying professorships at universities. There's a movement in Florida called UnKoch FSU that the graduate students are saying because they are paying professors to say what they want to say, restricting what they can publish. This is frightening, and it's like 400 universities around the country that are being influenced by their money. Yeah. And we've got to fight that. So yes, it is they call it the Koch-topus. It's the Koch-topus, okay? But in any event, it's up to us to help. So whether you think it's David and Goliath, we're David, all that money is Goliath, or better yet, think of yourselves as the merry men and the merry maids of Sherwood Forest, okay? And I encourage you to watch the original Robin Hood. I really do. It's one with Errol Flynn, Olivia de Havilland, Basil Rathbone. It will cheer you right up. It can be done. It can be done, and we can do it. Okay? Because so what we're asking you to do is pass the resolution, please. And believe me, we learned from our mistakes. In Florida, we started out saying, oh, have your social justice committee pass a resolution. No. You don't want 5 or 6 or 10 or 15 people. You want to get it before the congregation, use the materials that Michael has made available, or you can find it on the link on this little page, okay? The link on our website for UU Justice Florida, uujusticefl.org. You can find a link there. Then educate your people and bring it before a congregational meeting or your annual meeting. And hey, if some people say nay, that's okay. Get the count, yays, nays, abstentions. And then let's go forward, because more people will become ambassadors for this very important issue if they can do that. So, actually, am I supposed to say something else here? What else am I supposed to say? Yes, we have, of course, UUA, UU Service Committee, UU Service Justice Economic Committee, and our UU Justice Florida, that's what I'm involved in, an all-volunteer state network, by golly, and who's going to do it too? How many of you have a state network? How many of you have a UU SANS? Oh, not enough. Not enough. Every state should have a state network. Go to CUUQSAN, CUUSAN.org. That's the new website for the Coalition of Unitarian Universalist State Action Networks. Okay? Form one. If you don't have one yet, you want one. They're great because they can help your congregations get involved with social justice and go forward. We need to educate. That's what we're going to do. Then motivate people to vote at all levels, not just for president here or there. Motivate them to vote, because it's at all levels that the Koch brothers and their colleagues are buying elections, right down to school board. It's critical. We got to, everybody can get over the cynicism, listen to what you're doing, and vote. And then watch for election protection also, because that's going to be the next bottom line. If we get close enough to electing good people, watch what happens at the polls on election day. You need to have people there, being poll watchers, poll workers. Make sure every vote counts as cast. And I thank you so much. Let's do it.
And Kendra's our resident firecracker. She does. This is actually part of hers, but I wanted to show you. These are the cities and states around the country where some UU organization, whether it was a committee or a congregation, have signed the resolution and endorsed the move to amend. So see if you see yourself there quickly. I'm going to go right on through it. purpose of this, aside from hearing about Crash 2016, is for us to hear about you and what you're doing. So I am going to race through the next part, which is 22 congregations in Florida have passed resolutions. Thanks. Thanks to your work. You can do this in any other state. Kendra's an expert at it. So, now we're going to talk about the Interfaith Caucus. Some of you may have never heard of this. Remember that last line of the AIW that we said, reach out to congregations and other faiths? That's what's been happening for 2 years now with many of you. And it's really beginning to have an effect. At the end of 2013 GA, David Cobb, who is the spokesperson of Move to Amend, met with us and said, look, I think this is going to come together. We can really make a difference. Let's form something part of Move to Amend called the Interfaith Caucus. So we started that. I was honored to be the moderator, and we're developing this. What we found, if those of you who were in 2013 there, saw our analysis of the seven principles of UUs. We had a list of the seven principles, and then examples for everyone of how corporations are violating those principles. Now, we're certain that when we talk to other faiths, they're going to find the same thing in some form or other of whatever their values and beliefs and faith and doctrines are. They're going to find areas where corporations are violating them. The problem is, we are activists, let's face it, and not unfortunately, but the reality is that a lot of others, other congregations, other denominations, are more inward and not as outward-reaching as we are. But that's the way they are. But that doesn't mean they don't know and they don't care about these things. So our purpose now is to reach out to other congregations, to other faith communities, and this is the interesting part. We had a workshop in late 2013 where we had representatives of 9 different faiths together in Madison, Wisconsin, and we asked them, what are the things that you believe in, after telling them about what we had done. We took them off in corners. After I'd identified them, there was one bunch that was still sitting in the side in the front. And I said, who are you? And they said, we are atheists, agnostics, and humanists. And we have the same concerns. It may not be God-related, but we have the same concerns about what's going on. And I said, wonderful. Go and talk too, and let's see what we can come up with. So all these groups got together individually. We finished the conference, I took the papers home, and we put together, what do we have in common? Here's what they found. Every one of them, all three groups, agreed that the problems they're concerned with, which are violated by corporations all the time, are stewardship of all creation. Now, for humanist, agnostic, or atheist, they would probably say stewardship of the earth and all of its beings. But that's fine, same thing. The other one is, love thy neighbor. I'm not going to go into it now, but there are many cases any of us could think of love thy neighbor, whatever your neighbor happens to be, whether it's a country or a person. And the third is care and support of the poor. Resistance against minimum wages, resistance against unions, and again, the list goes on. These are all things that we can agree are negative, are damaging society. So we've been talking about this for quite a while now, and some of us have been going to conferences and conventions, talking to interfaith groups. We found that in a couple of these areas, love thy neighbor, care and support the poor, there can be differences of opinion when you talk to different religious organizations. And so what we found out recently, and this was just a couple of months ago, is that with a very, very small exception of the few evangelicals who still say, God made us, God is in charge. If this is happening, God wants it to happen. Who are we to think that we should be able to make change and slow this down? And, of course, we're going to be pulled up there pretty soon. That's a very, very small minority. All the others, evangelicals, fundamentals, Baptists, whatever the more conservative side of the religious spectrum is, are agreed we are stewards of creation or the planet. And the Pope, just last week, with his encyclical, absolutely. We have now got to rewrite all our literature because of that wonderful statement. He says, and this is in the Interfaith Caucus materials, climate change is real. We humans are causing it, Corporate greed is the primary factor in that, and people of faith can change it. He doesn't know about Move to Amend and the Interfaith Caucus. That's fine. He's done his job. Now it's up to us to bring together ourselves around the country and people of other faiths and ethical traditions and tell them, let them see, show them these four factors, and we have the ability to make this change. What does the Constitution start with? We the people. It doesn't say we the corporations. It is not we the corporations. We have the responsibility as citizens to take charge. We have given up. We have given up our sovereignty. We have allowed the Supreme Court, that's done lots of bad things, corporations to take over our responsibility and to be the influence, to be the organizing force for Congress, for the agencies, for our nation, for our politicians. The politicians don't dare come to them because they don't think they'd be elected. If we had their back because we are determined that we are going to change this, that we can get together and show our Congress people that, look, you support this, let's get the amendment, we'll re-elect you, it's going to happen. Because we are supreme, we have the right, we have the obligation to fix this. And those who say, what can we do? They won't let us do that. And I get that all the time. Is that true?
They want us to believe.
Sorry? They want us to believe that. That is not the truth. Again, repeat after me. We are supreme.
We are supreme.
Do you doubt that? Do you doubt that the Constitution makes us supreme? I know you don't. Okay, I'm going to finish right now because we want to hear from you. We've been doing this for 2 years. We've been in communication with lots of congregations. We've heard back from a few. But when I'm done, I'm going to introduce Judith, and she's going to manage our discussion with you. And I'm going to take notes. And let me reemphasize again, if you haven't already done it, please put your name and information on the sheets, because even if you don't think right now that you want to be involved with this, we will be able to send you materials that you will be able to give to other people in your congregation who may need to. So don't miss this opportunity to get into the pipeline of information and the ability to take off and take charge and turn our Constitution around. Okay. Today, as a result of many factors, here's where we are. We have a Facebook page, Move to Amend Unitarian Universalist. We have over 900 likes on that. That was created the day after the 2013 General Assembly action that we didn't witness. We have a Move to Amend Interfaith Caucus Facebook page. We're a little bit behind, but it's about 100, and we're beginning to get people from all sorts of other religions. We've done workshops and conferences in Florida, two in Chicago. There's one coming up around children of the interfaith and the climate that I'll be speaking at, and that's exciting. I've never had yet an audience of children, and that's, of course, where we've got to be. We've got to be talking to children. What we are doing now is not for us. It's for them. What else, if we don't, what are we giving them? And as I said, we have the Pope's encyclical. I was going to talk all about those things. Our organizing team is a mix of different religions, and we're delighted that we have that. Let me mention this, the Lutheran Synod in Florida, a couple of ladies who came to a workshop we did in February, have taken a resolution about Move to Amend to the headquarters, to the management of the Lutheran Synod in Florida, and they are optimistic that it's going to be approved. Can you imagine what that's going to mean? If that goes through for the Lutheran faith around the country, it could mean great things, and as an example to other faiths, it could mean even more. So we are on our way, and now we want to know what you have been doing. I hope, and I'm sure, that many of you are involved with Move to Amend, number one. I'm hoping that some of you are also involved with the Interfaith Caucus. And I'll turn this over now to Judith and Patterson Bennett. Okay, from Tennessee, who is one of our stalwart colleagues on the Interfaith Caucus. And she is going to ask you some questions. And if you'd like to, as soon as she identifies what she's going to talk about, step up to the microphone. I'm going to get on my little iPad here and start typing like crazy. And of course, we are recording this also, which, by the way, these films that are taken tonight and from David's meetings yesterday and the day before, we are going to get onto YouTube and onto websites, and we'll be sending you the information of where they're available so you can pass them on to others. without any more ado, let me introduce Judith, and you can take over, and I think we got it. Oh, okay, those are the ethical organization. Here we are, what's happening? That is the website of our page, the Interfaith Caucus on the Move to Amend website. Judith, it's all yours, and you don't need this anymore. I'll just turn that off.
And now for something completely different. You've heard from us, you know, what Tom Hartman and David Korten had to say, you know what the Interfaith Caucus is doing, you know what Move to Amend is doing, and now we want to hear what are you doing. I want to give a little bit of a shout out to the southern part of the country. You've heard what Kendra has done in Florida. I've been working in Tennessee and some in Georgia because that's close to us. If it's possible to do it in the South, it's possible to do it anywhere. So, we have a microphone. If you are working with the Interfaith Caucus or Move to Amend in your city, in your state, or in your congregation, we want to hear from you. Also, we're entertaining questions. So if you will come to the microphone, we will do our best to answer all of them and also to give you a voice.
Name and congregation. Name and congregation.
Yes, please.
Okay. I don't think this is on. This is not on. Yes.
Okay, I'll repeat it. So if you'll just say it loud enough for me to hear.
All right, I'll try to be loud. I'm Paul Dresden from the Unitarian Universalist.
Louder.
Well,
come closer.
Just come closer. Come closer, and I'll repeat what he says.
Give him your microphone. Give him your mic.
This mic.
I'm Paul Dresner from the Unitarian Universalist Congregation in Shelter Rock, and I just want to I have a question, and hopefully it's a constructive suggestion, because I agree in principle on what you're doing, because it aligns with what I believe are our UU principles. My comment and question is that corporations are a form of ownership, and one of the things that really needs to be addressed, because one could make the argument that a group of people who have democratic rights could vote and make a decision that other people might not agree with, and they would have the right to do that, and they might not accomplish exactly what you're talking about because they may not have the same values. The main issue with regard to corporations is the limited liability. The individual doesn't have the right generally to sue a corporation, and therefore they can do things, and the law permits them to do it without any check or balance. So my question is, and my constructive comment is, in regard to not only the Move to Amend, which would change or limit the corporation's rights to be treated as people or have different rights than people under the law, is there any thought to also attaching to that or also addressing the issue of liability? Because if one has a right, if a business is polluting the environment or doing something that's harmful to other people, if those people had a right to address that in the legal system, they would also have power that is a different kind of power that they might have through the democratic process, because we all always don't vote, and votes don't always turn out the way we'd like them to be.
Move to Amend and amending the Constitution are a first step. In and of itself, it doesn't change the laws. So everything that goes after that, that needs to be dealt with, and will be. Move to Amend and the effort to get the amendment is not going to be taking on, nor does it need to be taking on, all the specific issues of what is going to next be happening, because the laws are still in the books. So what is protected at that moment will continue to be protected until it is negated by by some court action of a corporation coming in and saying, you're violating my rights of such and such, and the decision from the judge saying, what right is that? At that point, the law needs to be discussed. What is certain is that when this amendment passes, we will have sufficient support around the country. Not we, but the Constitution and democracy will have sufficient support from we the people that we will be able to address the changes that need to take place. It's not going to be immediate, it's not going to be fast, but without removing corporate personhood and money of speech, nothing changes, because we can't change it so long as it is in this way. So I'm not answering your question, I'm just saying that these are the thousands of issues that will need to be taken up. There's nothing simple about this, there's nothing quick, but it is necessary. If we don't do it, we don't get change. We don't have the opportunity to fix the environment, to fix our education system. That's the simplest way to explain it, and we can get into discussions online and many other ways, and probably are, about the details as we go forward. Okay, thank you.
Hi, I'm Karen Kaufman with the First Unitarian Universal Society of Albany, New York. I've been very active in trying to get New York to be state number 17. I'm going to talk briefly about a little bit about our nitty-gritty strategies, and then I have a question, a big question about how do we get over the top. We have actually been working with Public Citizen, which is seems to be, you haven't mentioned this, but they are spearheading a fairly professional lobbying effort focusing on states that they think can get on board with this request to Congress. And they did seem to think that New York was one of those states, and we were working with a professional lobbyist from Washington, D.C. And now I have to sort of get into a little bit of partisan politics, because we have two houses divided by party in New York. We have no problem getting the Democratic Assembly to support this. We have a Republican-controlled Senate. The Democrats in that House have also indicated support, but we need to bring in a handful of Republicans to get us over the top, and that's been where our efforts have been focused. And I personally have visited the office of my own state senator, who's a Republican, like four times. I've spoken with her directly, personally. She, when I say Citizens United, she gave me a blank stare. And we've talked with three different staff people who I don't think are stupid. We've explained, all the good reasons for doing this, and seem to get nowhere. And this leads me to my final question, which is, Michael stated that you said very optimistically that we can go to our elected legislators and tell them that we're the powerful, supreme factor here, and they were risking not being reelected. But the fact is that they're meanwhile being supported monetarily by the other side, getting corrupt influence of money. And that, so far, seems to be counting the day.
We're not going to resolve issues right here. What we really want to know is who is working on various issues. And also, I'd love to hear if anybody here is working on interfaith caucus issues. We're putting our cart before the horse in this case. Move to Amend is a grassroots movement. We are not going to Congress today, legislator by legislator, and saying, would you please support this? Because for the most part, some of them are supporting parts of this, but for the most part, they're not going to, because they depend on money from the supporters to get elected. So the grassroots effort is to bring awareness to the whole country through congregations, through different faiths now, to get to the point where the tipping point is reached. And Tom Hartmann, if you were here, he would have said, I believe that's when we have about 20 million people who are aware of this and will support this and move it forward. So until then, some efforts in Congress, I understand, are receiving some success, but we don't think that we're going to get to the fundamental
Tom Hackett, UU Fellowship of Poughkeepsie, New York. I just have a very quick question. The people opposing this movement sometimes state that, or observe that we, the UUA, are a corporation, our individual congregations are incorporated, and that we will stand to lose rights under this amendment. How do we respond to that kind of assertion?
It's not that, as David Cobb says, it's not that we're going to lose. All that is going to be lost is the right to act as a person, not a corporation, but a person under the Constitution. It doesn't mean that you won't still have rights as a corporation, just not constitutional rights.
We need to come to a close because they've got to reset the room. But what I wanted to answer that question. If you put your name and contact information down, there's a document that we have prepared on this specific issue that there is a big difference between a for-profit corporation and a nonprofit as far as who has the rights. In a nonprofit, it is the members. In a for-profit, supposedly, is the corporation itself. So when a nonprofit has concerns with being told there are certain things they cannot do or they are not able to extend their rights, it's the rights of the members that are supreme, and they do not get changed when the corporation itself, nonprofit, is not